Good morning, everyone. It's such a joy for me today to see you all here for this very special occasion. If anyone's joining us for the first time, and if you're joining us as you know guests, I'd like to say thank you. Special thank you for being here with us this morning. Today is a very special day because you know today we are unwrapping a gift that God has given us. It's a very expensive gift. It's not a gift you can package in a box, and that makes today very special. So, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, friends and family of Shiloh Faith Point Church, I'm thrilled and excited to tell you, welcome to our new home. Can we give the Lord a big hand? Every Sunday we hear testimonies. We have people come forward, and testify about the great things, you know, that God's been doing. But I think today the greatest testimony is the place itself. I think this place of worship, this new place of worship that God has gifted us, testifies to how faithful and good He is. It testifies that He is able to provide. It testifies that He is good. And the fact that He is able to do above and beyond what we can think or ask. So it's truly wonderful to be a part of this special moment that God has granted us. And I believe God has beautiful memories in store for us in this new house. And He's going to take us on new adventures with a new beginning. So to honor Him and to ask for His blessing on our first service in this new house, we are going to join our hearts in prayer and begin. To do that, I'd like to call upon Pastor Deepak to lead us in prayer.
Let's pray. Father God, we want to thank You and praise You for this new day, O God. Your word says Your grace is new every morning. And Lord, great is Your faithfulness, O God. That's what Jeremiah says. We have seen Your faithfulness all throughout our lives, even in the ministry, O God. In this 20 years, You have blessed us, O God, and You have given us a new place. We want to thank You, and we want to give You all glory, honor, and praise, O Jesus. As we begin this new service, O God, in the new place, I pray that Your presence will be here, O God, every time we meet, every time we come together in fellowship, O God. When we call up Your name, O God, I pray that You will hear us, O Jesus. Every prayer that rendered here, O God, will be heard and will be answered, O Jesus. I pray that You will be glorified in this place, O Jesus. The purpose of this place is to glorify You, O God. As we gather every time, let Your name be exalted here, O Father. Every time when we come here, we want to hear from You, O Jesus. Every word which is going to be preached in this place will edify every member who is going to attend in this service. So, Father, I pray that Your presence will be felt by everyone who enters this place, O Jesus. That is the greatest transformation can happen in a person's life. Lord, we pray that will happen from today onwards, O God. We seek Your blessings. As Moses told, without You, we don't want to go anywhere, O God. We need You. We need Your presence in our lives, O God. You are our everything. Even we pray for today's service. Holy Spirit of God, take control of everyone, every proceeding that is going to take place here. Let it be ordained and let it come from Your Spirit, O God. We don't want to do anything on our own. Use Your people and bless us, O God. Let this service will be a blessing for everyone who gathered here, O God. Thank You, Jesus. Lord, speak to us. Speak Your word, O God. Let it be a blessing for everyone. Thank You, Jesus. We commit everything into Your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Deepak. Before we begin to praise and worship God, let's turn our Bibles to Psalm 27. Psalm 27. Psalm 27, and I would like to read verse 4 and verse 5, two favorite verses of mine. David writes, "One thing I ask from the Lord, and this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, and to gaze on the beauty of the Lord, and to seek Him in His temple. For in the day of trouble, He will keep me safe in His dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of His sacred tent, and He will set me high upon a rock." As we begin our first day here, I want to point out what makes this place very special. What makes this place very special is not the upgrade, although it's beautiful. You know, it's not the beautiful enhancements, you know, that we have, or the new amenities that we have compared to our previous, you know, venue. All that's wonderful, which God has, you know, gifted us. But what makes this place very special is that it belongs to the Lord. As David says, this is the house of the Lord. The person who truly owns this place is not the landlord, it's the Lord. This is His house. As even the Psalm 24, verse 1, it says, "The whole earth and everything in it belongs to the Lord." So how much more the house of the Lord? Usually when you go to someone's house, you go there to meet someone, right? And so if this is the house of the Lord, this is a place of meeting the Lord. This is the place where the Lord will meet with the people who are here. And so if there's someone who doesn't know the Lord, and if someone's going to walk in here, the Lord will meet that person if they don't know Him. And even if you do know Him, as you come into the house of the Lord, you can meet Him if you're coming looking for Him. Because it's a place of meeting the Lord. It's His house. And that's what makes this place special. So this is a place of meeting the Lord. And that's what David's writing in the psalm when he says, "There's one thing I desire the most. It's the fact that I can meet the Lord in His house." And he says, the one thing I desire the most is to meet Him every day. And once you meet Him, you will actually never be the same. If you notice, David says, "I want to meet Him so that I can look, I can gaze upon the beauty of the Lord." You know, the world doesn't understand beauty, because the world can often only think of beauty in terms of physical appearance. In world's eyes, beauty is all about, you know, the appearance on the outside. And that's the kind of beauty that fades away. But the beauty of the Lord, it shines forever. So what's the beauty of the Lord? It's about who He is. The beauty of the Lord is that He can never make a mistake, because He is perfect. He can never be surprised, because He is always in control. He can never learn anything new, because He knows it all. He can never be stopped. He can never be tricked, because He is the judge of all. He can never run out of resources, because He owns it all. He can never be overthrown, because He is the Lord of all. He can never be dazzled, because He is greater than all. That's the beauty of the Lord. But the most beautiful thing about Him is that even though He is so great, He humbled Himself for you and me. Though He is, you know, so big that this universe, which has billions of galaxies, cannot contain Him, He humbled Himself and He was born in a manger for you and me. That's the beauty of the Lord. Though you and I never deserved His love, He carried our cross. That's the beauty of the Lord. Though He was blameless, He took the blame for you. That's the beauty of the Lord. And He has given us a beautiful place this morning, but we've come here to worship His beauty. His beauty is the center of our worship, and He's the one we're going to worship now. So I want to call you to look on the beauty of the Lord. See how great He is. See how wonderful He is. May your eyes be on Him, and may you worship Him in the beauty of His holiness. So if you can all rise to your feet. let's enter into a time of worship.
Good morning, church. How's everyone this morning? Good? Fine? Great. So thank you, Ashwin, for that wonderful exhortation. Let's look at the beauty of our Lord. Amen. We're here this morning to thank Him. We're here this morning to be grateful to Him for everything that He's done. We can always look in our past and think of all the faithful things God has done. And this morning, as we come here to worship, let's just give Him the praise. Amen. Amen. Okay, can we put our hands together? Go with the beat. Sing praise, sing praise. One more time. Oh, sing praise, sing praise. Forever, forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. The rising to the setting sun, His love endures forever, and by the grace of God we will carry on. His love endures forever. Come on, church, sing praise, sing praise again. Oh, sing praise. Sing praise, sing praise. Lift your voices now. Sing praise, sing praise. Forever, forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever and ever. Forever. Hallelujah. Let's give Him a beautiful clap offering this morning. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, oh Master, you are faithful, oh God. You are faithful, oh God. Master, we thank you, Lord, that we can call this new place a new temple to offer worship unto you, oh God. Lord, we want to always remember, Lord, that the beauty is in you, O God. The beauty is all about you, O Master. And God, we just come here. We come here, O God, wanting to sing, wanting to lift our voices up to you this morning. Amen, church. Let's worship him in this house. Put your hands together, come on. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. Come on now. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung upon that cross, then he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. Come on now. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. Come on now. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars, and now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Come on, let's do that again. We were the beggars, and now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Come on, church. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. Come on. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. Amen. Amen. Come on, clap your hands for the Lord. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Isn't he a beautiful God, people of God? What a God we worship. What a God we worship. That he hears us. He hears our hearts. Thank you, Lord, for being so faithful in our lives, oh God. Thank you, Lord, for being here this morning, oh God.
Let your people continue to worship you. Let them continue to worship you, O Lord.
Can we just prepare our hearts, church? You know, I really love the psalm that Ashwin shared. David's heart was to dwell in the presence of the Lord all the days of his life. Do you know why? Because he was constantly bombarded by things around him. He was constantly being threatened. He was constantly being chased. But he said, as I gaze at the beauty of the Lord, I am in a safe place. I am in a safe place. Moses desired that beauty. Lord, show me your face, Lord. That was his desire. Show me your face, Lord. Let me see your glory. He knew he was not going to go into the promised land, but all he desired was his glory. Show me your face, Lord. Because when I see your face, that's my safe place. When Isaiah saw his glory, he fell prostrate and he was like, I'm a man of unclean lips. That's the beauty of his glory. There is strength within the sorrow. There is beauty in our tears. And you meet us in our mourning.
You are so-
promise, people of God.
And for your glory,
even in the valley,
even in the valley, you are
faithful. Oh, how faithful you are, sweet Jesus.
You're working for our good. You're working for our good.
Can we do that again?
And for your glory,
even when the enemy means for evil,
even what the enemy means for evil,
you work it for our
you
good. You will satisfy us with every good thing. Lord, I pray that today, whoever is here, Jesus, they will be satisfied by your love. If there is a longing, if there is a yearning, Lord, I pray that they will see you, Lord. They will see your glory. Oh, what beauty is there in that glory, Lord. Oh, captivate our hearts one more time, Jesus. That we can keep singing, holy, 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 holy are you, Lord. That we'll be so captivated by his holiness. Thank you. worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. We live for you. We live for you. Holy. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Oh,
open up my eyes in wonder.
trust will not be in man. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will.
Things are unclear, or when they're not constant. Lord, this morning we want to continue to set our focus, our heart, our mind on you, Jesus. The one who has called us is worthy. The one who has picked us up from the clay is worthy. The one who knows us by name is worthy. The one who knows the number of hair on our head is worthy. Lord, you know our ins and our out, our comings and our goings. Our needs you are aware of, our desires you know, oh God. We want to join together worshiping you, oh Master. The creation is worshiping, heaven is worshiping, oh God. Such might and wonder and majesty your name holds. We'll sing together, church. A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all have gone before us, and all who will believe, you got it, will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all power and positions. Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry. Sing, church.
Holy,
all creation cries. Forever to the Lamb. We'll sing the song.
description.
Too marvelous
for
words.
Too wonderful for comprehension,
Lord.
Like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom?
Your timing, oh God.
Who can fathom the depths of your love?
Jesus,
you are beautiful beyond description.
Majesty. This morning that you'll show us for from you are all things. For from you are all things and to you are all things, oh God. Everything that we will ever know, everything that we will ever experience, everything that we'll ever face, every day that we will ever have to walk, every day that we'll ever have to journey, oh God. There is nothing that you have not already seen before. There is nothing you haven't already walked ahead of. For you see everything, O Master Lord. This morning, O Lord, if any one of us here has not experienced the sovereignty of our God, the sovereignty and the majesty of Jesus, Lord, I pray that you'll come down in all your glory. You'll come down in all your glory, O Lord, to each and everybody, individually, O God. As we, O Master, we'll gather every Sunday, O, praising you, worshiping you, talking about your goodness, O God. I pray that every person who comes and join us here as we sing, O God, will be able to experience this majesty, this sovereignty, this glorious God that you are. This glorious God that you are. Far from you are all things, and through you are all things. You deserve the glory. One last time we sing together.
Far from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
You deserve the glory, Jesus. You deserve all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. And together we say, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Well, I'm going to read one of the most familiar verses for us all. It's from Psalm 91, and verse 1. It says, "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." I'm sure most of us know it by heart. And it's a psalm of promise. Every Christian mother prays over a child every day, right? There's so many promises that's there in this, in Psalm 91. It's also called a soldier's psalm. In World War II, every soldier who went into the battle recited this psalm for safety and protection. You know, it's a masterpiece. But today we will very briefly try to understand what's the background to this psalm. Most of us assume it is written by David, right? But the Bible scholars unanimously agree, and in line with the Jewish tradition, it is composed by Moses, right? And I tell you when exactly it was composed. It was composed by Moses on the day when he built the tabernacle and the glory of the Lord filled in the desert. And God's presence came and dwelt in the midst of his people. God said, "You pitch a tent for me, I will come and dwell in the midst of my people." The first time God expressed his desire that he wants to come and dwell with his people. He wants to live with his people, right? And it took so many months, and finally the tent was built and it was dedicated. And on that day, God's presence, it was very tangible, it was real. It came in the form of cloud and it rested on the tabernacle. I can read that verse as well. It's in Exodus chapter 40. Turn your Bibles to Exodus chapter 40. The last part of Exodus 40, we can find that verse. Exodus 40 verses 33 and 34. Exodus 40 verses 33 and 34. "Then Moses set up the courtyard around the tabernacle and altar and put up the curtain at the entrance to the courtyard. And so Moses finished the work." The work of the tabernacle is done. And then verse 34 says, "Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle." Then, when the tabernacle was finished, the Bible says, "The cloud of glory covered the tent, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle." It was right at that moment Moses was inspired to write Psalm 91. Right? When he entered into the presence of the Lord, he knew there's only one thing that is needed in life. He who dwells in the secret place, secret meeting place of God, he who dwells there, abides there, will come under the shadow of the Almighty. Moses was able to an extent see that the dangers that will befall the journey ahead. He was able to have an insight of what's going to happen, what's going to be the journey of the children of Israel. It's not an easy journey, right? There's going to be a lot of dangers. There's going to be a lot of uncertainties. It's going to take a long time before they reach the promised land. But one thing he was absolutely sure of, right? If only we can come under this presence, the cloud of glory. He had this inspiration to write the psalm. Lord, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And you know, all the promises that's listed there in Psalm 91, he shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge, you shall not be afraid of the terror that flies by, the arrow that flies by, the pestilence that walks at noonday, right? And 1,000 shall fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand. You shall trample over the lion and all those promises are linked to that first verse. All those promises. It becomes a reality to the one who chooses to dwell in the shadow of the Almighty. And Moses realized that. All the promises that we need in life, you know, we can experience it when you choose to dwell in the presence of God. Right? And we do not know what our journeys are ahead. We do not know. There are so many uncertainties. We don't know what befalls us tomorrow, you know, what holds for us. I'm sure God is in control of our lives, right? But we are not sure. We are very uncertain of our future. But there's one thing that is, we are sure. We can hold on to all the promises of God. Psalm 91 is a psalm of promise, right? Every verse you pick, there's a promise for you. But that applies to the one who dwells in the secret place of the Most High. You know, when the cloud of glory comes down, when God's presence comes down to be in our midst, that's when we find peace, that's when we find His presence, that's where we find prosperity, that's where we find protection. Everything comes in the presence of God, right? And this morning we are going to invoke God's presence. I'm sure that's what you want in life, right? That's what I want as well in my life. I want His presence. He who dwells in the secret place. It's a secret meeting place. It's between you and God, right? And we have sung these songs. We have had the exhortation. And all that we desire this morning is we want God to come and fill this place with His presence, right? So we're going to invoke His presence this morning. Even as we are inaugurating this house, we are dedicating this house for the Lord, for His glory. We are invoking His presence. We say, Lord, without Your presence, we can't do anything. We want You to come and fill us, fill each and every one of us, because that's where all our promises come true, in His presence. Amen. So I'm going to ask Janet to come and take us through a psalm of praise. Yeah.
Let's continue to praise our God. Can we turn to Psalm 145? And we'll praise His name by reading the entire psalm. Psalm 145. I will exalt You, my God and King, and praise Your name forever and ever. I will praise You every day. Yes, I will praise You forever. Great is the Lord. He is most worthy of praise. No one can measure His greatness. Let each generation tell its children of Your mighty acts. Let them proclaim Your power. I will meditate on Your majestic, glorious splendor and Your wonderful miracles. Your awe-inspiring deeds will be on every tongue. I will proclaim Your greatness. Everyone will share the story of Your wonderful goodness. They will sing with joy about Your righteousness. The Lord is merciful and compassionate, slow to get angry, and filled with unfailing love. The Lord is good to everyone. He showers compassion on all His creation. All of Your works will thank You, Lord, and Your faithful followers will praise You. They will speak of the glory of Your kingdom. They will give examples of Your power. They will tell about Your mighty deeds and about the majesty and glory of Your reign. For your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. You rule throughout all generations. The Lord always keeps his promises. He is gracious in all he does. The Lord helps the fallen and lifts those bent beneath their loads. The eyes of all look to you in hope. You give them their food as they need it. When you open your hand, you satisfy the hunger and thirst of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in everything he does. He is filled with kindness. The Lord is close to all who call on him. Yes, to all who call on him in truth. He grants the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cries for help and rescues them. The Lord protects all those who love him, but he destroys the wicked. I will praise the Lord, and may everyone on earth bless his holy name forever and ever. We'll read the last verse again. I will praise the Lord, and may everyone on earth bless his holy name forever and ever. Amen.
So thank you, Janet. So, dear people of God, the Bible tells us that God is well pleased to dwell in the midst of his people who are gathered in his name. King Solomon was intrigued by this great mystery. He wondered, but will God really dwell on earth with humans? The heavens, even the highest heavens, cannot contain him. How much less this temple? We have this promise in 2 Corinthians 6:16. We are the temple of the living God. And God said, I will live with them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. So we remember how God filled the tabernacle of Moses and the temple of Solomon with his tangible glory on the day it was dedicated. We believe God will also approve and bless us with his presence as we dedicate this house in a solemn manner for the various acts of Christian worship. Dear people of God, we are gathered here today to dedicate and inaugurate this place as a church for the service and worship of the Almighty God. So, people of God, if we can all rise up right now, please, can all stand to our feet. And when I pronounce the purpose of this house, I request all of us to join with me and say, we dedicate this house, okay? I'll say the people said, and you will say, we dedicate this house. To the glory of God the Father, creator of heaven and earth, to the glory of God the Son, redeemer of the world, to the glory of God the Holy Spirit, sanctifier of the faithful. And the people said, we dedicate this house. For the worship of God in prayer and praise, for the preaching of the eternal gospel, for the celebration of the Holy Communion. And the people said, we dedicate this house. For the comfort of all who mourn, for strength to those who are tempted, for the healing of those who are sick, for light to those who seek Christ's ways. And the people said, we dedicate this house. For the hallowing of family life, for teaching and guidance of the young, for the perfecting of the saints. And the people said, we dedicate this house. For the confession of sins, for the promotion of righteousness, for the extension of God's kingdom. And the people said, we dedicate this house. In the unity of the holy Christian faith, in the bond of Christian fellowship, in love and goodwill to all,
And the people said, "We dedicate this house for the preparing of the church, which is the bride of Christ, for getting men and women ready for the soon return of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ back to the earth again." And the people said, "We dedicate this house." Now, O Lord, let your eyes be open toward this house day and night, and let your ears be open to receive the prayers of your children, which they offer to you in this place. May your rich blessing be upon this house, which we dedicate to your honor. May your priests be clothed with righteousness. May your saints rejoice in the glory of your salvation. May we all grow up into a holy temple in the Lord, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit be glory and praise forever and ever. And the people said, Amen.
As we remain standing, we're going to pray and dedicate this house. I'm going to call Pastor Charles. He's my friend from Dubai. Please come over, Charles. So we have a very long-standing relationship. It goes all the way to our old days, good old days in Bishop Heber. Right? And I'm very proud that he's a pastor now serving the Lord in Dubai. And all those things for another day. I'm sure he'll come back to minister to us. So I'm very happy that he's here with us to pray. And I also have Pastor Santosh. Santosh, please come. It's a travesty of justice if I have to introduce him. He's a household name. So we're going to, as we unite our hearts together, I'm going to ask these men of God to pray and dedicate the house for God's glory.
Sure. Praise the Lord. All right. For this day alone, you can open your mouths and say, praise the Lord. Thank you very much. Let's go to Acts chapter 10, verse 38. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth
with the Holy Spirit and power.
How he went around doing good and healing all who, healing people, and people who were oppressed by Satan. Right? What was, you'll see this, you'll experience this in your, in this house. God moves in seasons. If you don't mind, can I get somebody on the keys just for a moment? Right? Somebody do this. That song, Day and Night, Incense Arise. We go by seasons. That's a waiting season, and then you have a harvesting season. You waited since 1998. It's more than 20 plus years. It's not about the count, head count we see, because I know about you. It's about the power we develop. It's one Elijah who stands among 800 plus people. So who do you equate with? 800 plus is great, or the single one? So we are such kind of peculiar breed. The world might be many in numbers, but we just stand alone. The one who is greater in me, the one in me is greater than the one who's in the world. You believe it or not? Let's shout in hallelujah. Day and night. Day and night, there'll be incense arising from this place. That's what the temple is meant for. There was a time Samuel was doing his priesthood, and there was a time Christ came as the high priest. He said, I'll come and live in your heart, in your heart, and in my heart. I'll make this flesh which is out of mud and dirt a holy temple, which will glorify the name of Christ. Oru naal varum. என்னுடைய சரீரமே உருவழிந்து கரைந்து போனாலும் நான் எனக்குள் வைத்திருந்த மகிமையின் நம்பிக்கையான கிறிஸ்து என்னுடைய சமூகத்தில் சேர்ப்பார். That's the hope of a Christian. A day will come, your own body will be gone, but the hope of Christ, the glory of Christ that you carried in your physical body, and that's the power of salvation. That's the power of salvation. You know who we are? Asayai pin todalagravargal. Nan adaindhen theri vittan endralla. அடைந்து ஆயிற்று என்று அல்ல. It's not that I have attained. I press on for the high prize of my calling. A day will come, I'll come back with the king and reign with him. And that's why this church, this facility, these people around here, this call, your dedication, everything, everything, everything. That glory should come and dwell in your heart. That's what Sheridan was talking about. He was talking about Solomon. Solomon, you know what Solomon prayed? He bent down, he fell on his face and prayed, Lord, what would you do in this place? He said, oh, the prayers that you offer in this place will be heard and answered. It's not that it will be heard, it will be heard and answered. And he asked about the others, what about the rest of the world when they come and pray here? He said, that too will be answered. That's why, you know, today the wall is standing as a single piece of block wall there. People go write notes on it and stuck in between the wall gaps, you know, the stone gaps in Jerusalem, believing that what is prayed in the temple will be heard and answered. Amen. And that glory which was so thick, it's a cloud of glory, Shekinah glory. A moment of time came, it became as a word of God. And he said, I'll come and dwell in this body, in your body, in their body, and I will rule and reign over you, and you shall be called the royal priesthood and a kingly generation. Amen. How many of you really want that Christ to come in your hearts and rule? Could you just lift up your hands straight up? Go with me to Romans chapter 8, the latter part of it. Romans 8:9. ரோமர் 8:9 ஒன்பதாவது வசனத்துடைய பிற்பாகத்தை எடுத்து வாசிப்போம். Day and night, night, night and day, incense. Romer 8:9. Aloud or more? Just for the liberty I take among you, let's go with the Tamil version reading. Hold on with that. Tamil la vasinga romba alaga irukum. Thank you, Lord. Nal sathama vasinga Kristuvinudaya Kristu ungalil irundal aha aha right aha ஓகே அது பிற்பாக வாசிங்க கிறிஸ்துவினுடைய ஆவி இல்லாதவன் அன்றியும் எஸ் எழுப்பினவருடைய ஆவி உங்களில் வாசமாக இருந்தால் தட்ஸ் வாட் தி டெம்பிள் டாக்ஸ் அபவுட் இஃப் தட் ஸ்பிரிட் ரிசைட்ஸ் இன் யூ ட்வெல்ஸ் இன் யூ மூவ்ஸ் இன் யூ டிரைவ்ஸ் யூ எஸ் ப்ளீஸ் எட்டு ஒன்பது பிற்பாக கரெக்டாக வாசிங்க கிறிஸ்துவனுடைய ஆவி இல்லாதவன் அவருடையவன் அல்ல. கிறிஸ்டியானிட்டி இஸ் ஆல் அபவுட் கேரிங் த டெம்பிள் கேரிங் தட் ஸ்பிரிட் இன் யூ. ஆமென். ஹவ் மெனி ஆஃப் யூ கம் வித் மீ சே எஸ் பாஸ்டர். என்ன வேணா பண்ணலாம், நீங்கள் அந்நிய பாஷையில் பேசலாம், டே அண்ட் நைட் இன்சன்ஸ் ரைஸ் எல்லாம் பாடலாம், யூ கேன் பி த பெஸ்ட் பர்ஃபார்மர், பட் இஃப் ஹிஸ் ஸ்பிரிட் டசன்ட் டுவெல் வித் யூ, வித்இன் யூ, upon you, around you, all those, but just leave that within you. You know what happens? You get a mark of blood seal, a mark of the spirit seal on your top of your head. The day he returns, you'll see those marked ones. Pick it up. They're going to go with them in the air. And your hope will never be lost. That's what the Lord says. The hope which you've been battling for the past 3 years, how the Lord dealt with you. He dealt with you in a very peculiar way. The apostolic season is opening up. Amen. Rasha kathar. Inda aalayathukku theva Kristuvanudaya aavi illadavan avarudayavan illa. Enna da irundhalum andha aaviyanavar ulle onnume illa. It's like left out. But you know something, on the last day of the feast, he said, those who are thirsty, You may come unto me. I can give you living waters which will make you never thirst again. Amen. And that can be found in the house of the Lord. You know why I said this story? It has got a connection with the temple coming in. The Ark of the Covenant moving into your heart. The commandments, the life, the blood, the power, the spirit. And what comes and dwells in your heart. Avan veru manidhanai marvan, aval veru manishiyai marval. That's what happened with Saul. When the spirit came, he became a different person. Let's pray and inaugurate. Right? We'll bless Shiloh Faith Point. Harvesters Church. That's the vision. Right? Rikama Shekel Hadi. How many of you like Sheridan? That's a peculiar question. If 10 says yes, 20 will say no. So that shows he's equal to a good pastor. Right? Right. Amen. How many are you willing to join with me to bless the temple of God? Amen. Let revelations flow, O God. Ribana Shikara Labasia. Day and night. Just one word. I know that it's not an easy task to set up a building like this and gather such a congregation and lead people. It demands a lot of sacrifices on the altar. The pain that you go through, the trials, being in this pathway, I know how it is. Today we pray the power of God will come and fall upon every one of you here. Let revelations come forth, let prophecy spring forth, let discernments of spirits operate, healing will be the least of your miracles. Amen. That shall be the least of your miracles. It'll be a regular continuous occasion. You just walk in with your sick bodies, you go out jumping like the fellow who had a lame foot standing outside the beautiful gate, and he jumped into the synagogue and praised God. Such wondrous things will take place. Shikara Masya. Let's close our eyes. Let's raise our hands, open our hearts, and just say out of our mouth, bless this temple, O God. Let voices raise up. More than everything, more the instruments. It's God wants your voices, the high voices of his children, to be raised up to the heavens. And he says, I'm a God who watches over every flesh. Shakatara Masia. We dedicate this place, this space, for thy glory alone, for only thy glory. Only thy glory, the maker of all, the king of glory, will walk now in this place with your magnificent presence, O God. Shakitara Basia. O Rabani Akadia. As he said in Psalms 91, as Moses said, let your presence come forth so that I will move and everything will be possible. That which is impossible by man will be made possible by God. Devanale yellam kudum. Manidanala kudada karyam devanale kudum. Kartharudaiya vallamai inda edathil irangi varuvadhaga. Umudaiya velai karanaga. Andavare Pastor Sheridanodu irundhu indha edathai naangal andavare aashirvadikkirom. Indha edatha thuvakka vizha kalaitha indha thuvakka jabathai yeredukkirom. We lift our hands up to you. Let's all lift our hands to the heavens. Everybody, you have come here to bless him and the place and his service. Everyone, vaigala thirandha andavare bless, aashirvadinga. Idhu oru harvesters church a irupadhaga. Aruvadaiyo yeralam aatkalo konjam aruvadaikku yajaman aatkalai anuppumbadikku indha velaiyila neenga ellarum karangala uyarthi andavare indha sabaiyil irundhu from this congregation andavare you will raise pastors, you'll raise prophets, you'll raise teachers, you'll raise shepherds, and you will raise the great apostle people out of this place. Rakamata, we break every stronghold, we break every demonic intervention, we make every block wall. I demolish them. I command in the name of Lord Yahshua Mashiach, Raka the Lord Jesus Christ, let his blood take its place. Here, let the power of blood speak in the people's heart. Curses be broken, bondages be broken,
all the blockways shall be broken. There shall be highways opening in this place right now. Lima mama shekere. We dedicate this place. We inaugurate this place. We submit this place. And the people over here, there shall be a revelational chapter taking place from now on. A history shall be created again. Oh Rakabadia, things that are called failures shall be removed out of the dictionary and made and be written possible with God, possible by God. Let the revelation of the word from now on shall come upon, specially upon Sheridan of God, that he will dwell in the realm of the word, realm of the word, in the spiritual realm of the word, and bring down fiery revelations, messages and sermons and secrets from the heavens that will change the hearts of people, will transform lives, which will pull them out of sin and sickness, oh God, will pull them out of bondages and all kinds of curses. And there shall be a river of blessing flowing in this place. Shakatara badia, rakal madia. Let's take a minute and pray in the spirit and ask the fire to come down and the presence to move among us. Raka, let angels minister. Let the ministering spirits hover around in this place. That's the glory. That's the glory. That's the glory. Every prayer, every intercessory word that is offered and uttered in this place shall be heard by the Lord of heavens, and he will answer and hear, and he will bless it. Shakalavadi antariya. Every weapon of the enemy shall never, ever prosper against you, your family, and the ministry which you carry in your heart, for the work that you carry in your heart. For all these days you've been waiting to carry that glorious presence. Rakabarashi, I pray, make Sheridan a glorious carrier, and that glory shall pass from one to another. I pray the every congregation standing here, Lord, I pray there shall be carriers. They shall be the carriers of your glory and your power. Glory and your power. Glory and your power. No man shall stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, I will be with you. I'll be with you. I'll strengthen you. Lord, I pray, stretch out your arms from the heavens. The right hand of God that lifts us up. Ulayana settilirundu thooki edukkaramudaiya karam inge irukkira ovvoruvar melum indha edathin melum indha aalayathin melum indha ooliyathin melum upon this place in the ministry for which he has been called for. Bless it, Lord. Bless. Okay, in the spirit of God, it's pushing me to tell you the apostolic work you will see through your very own eyes. You will see the apostolic move in this place. That season unfolds. Rakantara mashi tire kere babari kalkadia. Let fire come down, O God. Let fire come down. Let thy glory and your fire, glory and your fire. There shall be the Holy Spirit power baptism upon you. There shall be a fire anointing coming down now. Coming down now. So we sanctify this place. We sanctify this place. We consecrate this place. We dedicate it for thy glory, O God. There shall be incense day and night be arisen in this place. Hallelujah. 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 I pray for everyone standing over here. May you touch them and bless them and make them a blessing for millions. May Shiloh Faith Point Harvesters Church, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, I pray the prayer of consecration, blessing, and power, and thy glory to rest upon it. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
நேரத்தில் ஆண்டவரை நோக்கி பார்க்கலாம். இந்த ஆலயத்தை அவருக்கென்று நாம் பிரதிஷ்டை செய்யும்படியாக இந்த இடத்துல கூடி வந்திருக்கின்றோம். இந்த ஸ்தலம் தேவனுடைய பிரசன்னத்தால் நிரம்புகிற ஒரு ஸ்தலமாக, எப்பொழுதெல்லாம் நம்ம இங்கே அவரை ஆராதிக்கும்படியாக ஜனங்கள் இங்கே கூடி வருகிறாங்களோ, அப்பெல்லாம் இந்த இடத்துல ஒன்றே ஒன்று தான் தேவை, ஆண்டவருடைய அந்த பிரசன்னம். அவருடைய பிரசன்னம் வந்துச்சு அப்படின்னா, அவருடைய பிரசன்னம் இறங்கி வந்துச்சுன்னா, நம்ம என்ன சூழ்நிலையில் இங்கே வந்திருந்தாலும் அந்த பிரசன்னம் நம்முடைய சூழ்நிலையில் நம்ம மூடி பேசும், நம்மை வழி நடத்தும், நம்முடைய தடைகளை மாற்றும், நம்முடைய நிலைமை மாறும். அவருடைய பிரசன்னம் ஒன்று தான் தேவனுடைய ஆலயத்தினுடைய அடையாளமே, அங்கே அவருடைய பிரசன்னம் இருக்கணும். எனவே இந்த ஆலயத்தை இந்த நாளில் நம்ம அவருடைய பிரசன்னத்துக்கு என்று சொல்லி நம்ம பிரதிஷ்டை செய்ய போகிறோம். ஆண்டவர் தான் தங்கணும், தான் நான் மனிதர்களோடு உலாவணும், எனக்குன்னு சொல்லி ஒரு வாசஸ்தலம் இருக்கணும் அப்படின்னு சொல்லி ஆண்டவர் ரொம்ப விரும்பி, அவர் தன்னுடைய இருதயத்தினுடைய விருப்பத்தை தாவீது புரிந்து கொண்ட பொழுது கர்த்தர் ரொம்ப சந்தோஷப்பட்டார். யாருடைய யாருக்குமே இல்லாதபடி தாவீது எனக்காக ஒரு ஆலயத்தை கட்டணும் அப்படின்னு சொல்லி அவன் விரும்பினான்னு அதை தெரிந்தது நிமித்தம் கர்த்தர் ரொம்ப அருமையாய் தாவீது ஆசீர்வதித்தார், அவனுக்கு வாக்கு தத்தங்களை கொடுத்தார். அதற்கு காரணம் தேவனுக்கு ஒரு ஆலயம் வேணும்னு தாவீது கட்ட விரும்பினதுனால ஆண்டவர் ஆலயத்தில் அவர் இறங்கி வந்து வசிக்க விரும்புகிறார். எனவே இந்த சபை, இந்த ஆலயம், இந்த ஸ்தலம் தேவனுடைய பிரசன்னத்தை வரவேற்கிற ஒரு ஸ்தலமாக இது இருக்கும்படியாக இதை நாம் தேவனுக்கு என்று சொல்லி நம்ம பிரதிஷ்டை செய்ய போகிறோம். அப்படி நம்ம எல்லாரும் நம்முடைய வலது கரத்தை நம்ம உயர்த்தி கொள்ளலாமா? நம்முடைய வலது கரங்களை நம்ம ஆண்டவருக்கு நேராக நம்ம உயர்த்துவோமா? நிறைவே நீர் வாருமே, நிறைவே நீர் வேண்டுமே, நிறைவே நீர் போதுமே, ஆவியானவரே நிறைவே நீர் வாருமே, நிறைவே நீர் வேண்டுமே, நிறைவே நீர் போதுமே, ஆவியானவரே நீர் வாருமே, நீர் வாருமே, நீர் வாருமே, ஆவியானவரே. பரிசுத்த ஆவியானவரே, இதுவுமே நாங்கள் வரவேற்கிற ஆண்டவரே, நீர் இறங்கி வாங்கப்பா இந்த ஸ்தலத்தை ஆண்டவரே, உமக்கென்று சொல்லி எங்கள் தேவனுக்கென்று சொல்லி நாங்கள் பிரதிஷ்டை செய்கிறோம் ஆண்டவரே. இந்த ஸ்தலத்தில் என்னாலும் உம்முடைய பிரசன்னம் நிறைந்திருக்கணும் ஆண்டவரே, என்னாலும் உம்முடைய மகிமை இந்த இடத்துல நிறைந்திருக்கணும் ஆண்டவரே. யாரெல்லாம் இந்த ஆலயத்துக்குள்ளே வருகிறாங்களோ உம்மை பாடும் பொழுது, நாங்கள் ஆண்டவரே அந்த டெஸ்டிமனி இங்கே ஷேர் பண்ணும் பொழுது, உம்முடைய வார்த்தையை பிரசங்கிக்கும் பொழுது ஆண்டவரே, இந்த இடத்துல அளவில்லாத தேவ மகிமையை, தேவ பிரசன்னத்தை நிறைவை ஆண்டவரே, பரிசுத்த ஆவியானவருடைய அசைவாடுதல், உம்முடைய தொடுதலை, உம்முடைய மகிமையை இந்த இடத்தில் நாங்கள் ஒவ்வொருவரும், வரக்கூடிய ஒவ்வொரு ஜனமும் பார்க்கும்படியாக இந்த ஸ்தலத்தை உம்முடைய பிரசன்னத்துக்கென்று நாங்கள் ஆண்டவரே பிரதிஷ்டை செய்கிறோம் ஆண்டவரே, தேவ மகிமைக்கென்று இந்த இடத்தை பிரதிஷ்டை செய்கிறோம் ஆண்டவரே. இதை நீர் ஆளுகை செய்வீராக. கர்த்தருடைய கண்கள் எப்பொழுதும் இந்த இடத்தை நோக்கி கொண்டிருக்கட்டும். இங்கிருந்து ஏறெடுக்கப்படுகிற ஒவ்வொரு ஜெபங்களுக்கும் தேவனுடைய செவிகள் என்னாலும் திறந்திருக்கட்டும் ஆண்டவரே. அன்றைக்கு சாலமோன் தேவாலயத்தில் ஆசாரியர்கள் உட்பிரவேசிக்க கூடாதபடிக்கு தேவ மகிமை, தேவ பிரசன்னம் அந்த இடத்தை மூடி இருந்தது போல, இந்த ஸ்தலத்திலையும் என்னாலும் உம்முடைய பிரசன்னம் தங்கி இருக்கும்படியாக இந்த ஆலயத்தை நாங்கள் பிதா குமாரன் பரிசுத்த ஆவியானவருடைய நாமத்தினால இதை நாங்கள் பிரதிஷ்டை செய்கிறோம் ஆண்டவரே. நீர் தங்கி உலாவி உம்முடைய ஜனங்களை நீர் தொட்டு ஆசீர்வதிக்கிற ஒரு மகிமை ஸ்தலமாக இதை நீங்க வைக்க போவதற்காக நன்றி ஆண்டவரே. அநேக ஜனங்களை இந்த இடத்துல கொண்டு வாங்க, அந்த பிரசன்னம், அந்த தேவ மகிமை அநேகரை இந்த ஆலயத்துக்குள்ள நடத்தி வரட்டும் ஆண்டவரே. இந்த சென்னை பட்டணத்தில் அநேகருக்கு ஒரு ஆசீர்வாதத்தின் திருச்சபையாக தேவ சத்தத்தை, தேவனுடைய சத்தியத்தை ஆண்டவரே இந்த இடத்துல பேசுகிற ஒரு சபையாக இதை நீங்க வைக்கும்படியாக நாங்கள் ஜெபிக்கிறோம் ஆண்டவரே. உம்முடைய கரத்தில் இந்த சபையும் ஊழிக்காரர்களையும் வந்திருக்க ஒவ்வொரு குடும்பத்தார்கள் விசுவாசிகளையும் நாங்கள் அர்ப்பணிக்கின்றோம். நீரே ஆசீர்வதியும் வழி நடத்துங்க. உம்முடைய நாம மகிமைப்படுத்தும். இயேசு கிறிஸ்துவின் நாமத்தில் வேண்டுகிறோம் நல்ல பிதாவே, ஆமென், ஆமென்.
Can we give the Lord a hand of praise? Please be seated. Please be seated. Thank you so much, Charles and Santosh, for your prayers. I'm sure the Lord has started a great work, and we will see his glory manifest with our very eyes. Thank you so much. God bless you. Yeah, I'm going to ask Yovan to come and give a special number.
விடுவதில்லை என்றுரை செய்தீரன்றோ. நான் ஒரு போதும் உன்னை கைவிடுவதில்லை என்றுரை செய்தீரன்றோ. கடல் ஆழத்திலும் அக்கினி சூழையிலும் என்னை காத்திடும் பலவானன்றோ. விஷ சர்ப்பங்களோ சிங்க கூட்டங்களோ பயம் வேண்டாம் உன்னருகில் நான் என்றுரை செய்தவரை ஆராதிப்போம். ஆவியில் ஆராதனை என்றுரை செய்தவரை ஆராதிப்போம். ஆவியில் ஆராதனை அசாத்தியங்கள் சாத்தியமே தேவா உங்கள் வார்த்தையாலே. அசாத்தியங்கள் சாத்தியமே தேவா உங்கள் வார்த்தையாலே. அசையாத மலை கூட அசைந்திடுமே, அமராத புயல் கூட அமர்ந்திடுமே. அசையாத மலை கூட அசைந்திடுமே, அமராத புயல் கூட அமர்ந்திடுமே. எல்லா துதியும் எல்லா கனமும் என்னில் அசத்தியம் செய்பவர்க்கே. எல்லா துதியும் எல்லா உயரும் என்னில் நீலை வரமானவர்க்கே. எனக்காய் நிற்கும் இயேசுவுக்கே, எனக்காய் பேசும் இயேசுவுக்கே, எனக்காய் நிற்கும் இயேசுவுக்கே, எனக்காய் பேசும் இயேசுவுக்கே. நான் எடுத்த தீர்மானங்கள் ஒன்றின் பின்னால் தோற்றனவே. நான் எடுத்த தீர்மானங்கள் ஒன்றின் பின்னால் தோற்றனவே. சோராமல் எனக்காக உழைப்பவர், தோற்காமல் துணை நின்று காப்பவர். சோராமல் எனக்காக உழைப்பவர், தோற்காமல் துணை நின்று காப்பவர். எல்லா துதியும் எல்லா கனமும் நம்மில் அசாத்தியம் செய்பவர்க்கே. எல்லா துதியும் எல்லா உயரும் நம்மில் நிலை வரமானவர்க்கே. எனக்காய் நிற்கும் இயேசுவுக்கே, எனக்காய் பேசும் இயேசுவுக்கே, நமக்காய் நிற்கும் இயேசுவுக்கே, நமக்காய் பேசும் இயேசுவுக்கே. நான் ஒரு போதும் உன்னை கைவிடுவதில்லை என்றுரை செய்தீரன்றோ.
Thank you.
You know, after the praise and worship and everything, I actually forgot what I am supposed to be doing now. You know, was it not wonderful? God is faithful. And but in the process, you know, thinking back to see, to build such a small church, you know, to renovate it, how difficult. You know, I really felt sad for this guy in the Bible. Do you know what's his name? Who's that? Solomon. Just think how he would have suffered to build the temple of God in those days, even though there was nothing with you. But God, who was faithful to Solomon, he was also faithful to us. He helped us, right? Can we give the Lord a round of applause for all that he has helped us? You know, if you are standing today, it was only his grace. Can we keep that ad growing for a minute? Because he deserves better and better and better. All glory to God for what we are seeing today. Amen. So, few announcements. So, the church service here will be every Sunday at 10 a.m. So, please do feel free to come. And then, we have a youth program called Solid Grounds. It happens on every third Saturday. And it's a program for the youth where we have a lot of games, fun, you know, and at the same time, teaching them about the Bible and helping them, you know, to know more about Christ. And we also have group discussions which really help them. And then we have the church prayer at 8 o'clock every Wednesday. And the first and third Wednesday, we pray for the church. And the second and fourth, we do pray for the nation. If there's also a fifth Wednesday. So we still pray for the church on that day. Okay? And now, we have a couple of birthdays coming up this week. We have Isaac celebrating his birthday on the 7th of August. And we have Elizabeth Mary, who's celebrating a birthday on the 8th. Sorry, for those of you who don't know, that's Millie. Any of us know, because we all, you know, thinking who's that. So, can we all join together and pray? Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for this wonderful day, Lord. We just come here and we tell you our hearts are filled with so much of joy, oh Lord, this day. And as we stand in your presence, oh God, Lord, we just thank you for all that you have done in our lives and in this church, oh God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, God. You are so wonderful, oh Father. Lord, as we come, we pray for Isaac, oh Lord Jesus. We thank you for Isaac, oh Lord. Lord, we pray you bless him. Lord, give him good wisdom, good knowledge, oh Father. Even as he grows up, oh Lord Jesus, we pray, Lord, that you will be with him, oh God. You will lead him, oh Father. Lord, we pray you will bring him up, oh Lord Jesus. You will be, Lord, with him, oh Father, and everything that he does will be a blessing, not only to him, but to his family and to the people around him, oh Lord Jesus. We also pray for Millie, oh Lord Jesus. Thank you, God. Lord, thank you for calling her. Thank you for choosing her. Thank you for the talents that you have put in her, oh Lord Jesus. We pray, Lord, you will bless her, oh Lord Jesus, and use her for your glory, oh Lord Jesus. Thank you, God, for the great plans you have for her, oh Lord Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit of God. God, the plans to prosper, oh Father. Thank you, Father. Lord, even as we come this day, oh Lord Jesus, and we come to listen to your word, we pray, Father, that you speak to us through your word, oh God. We surrender the rest of the service into your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, the title of my message this morning is When God Does a Miracle. And I'm sure we are short of time, so I'll try and keep it as brief as I could. But I believe this is the message that God has for each and every one of you. So I'm going to focus on one recurring theme that's found in the book of Psalms. I'm just going to pick up a few verses here and there from a collection of Psalms. And interestingly, all these Psalms are written by one man. That's Asaph. You know, if you know your Bibles, you would probably know exactly where these psalms actually come in the whole collection, right? So what we're going to do is see this one theme that keeps recurring again and again, expressed very painfully, agonizingly by one man, okay? One theme, one man. Let's read it. I'm going to turn you to Psalm 74. Turn your Bibles to Psalm 74. There are a few verses I'm going to pick up and we are going to read through that. Psalm 74 verse 10. How long will the enemy mock you, O God? How long will you allow the enemy to dishonor your name? That's what the psalmist is lamenting. Okay, next verse, very quickly. Psalm 74 verse 9. Well, listen to this. We are given no miraculous signs, no prophets are left, and none of us know how long will this be. So again, he's languishing. There is all the miracles are dried up. We can't see any miraculous signs happening in our lives, in this nation, right? All the prophets are gone. We have no prophetic guidance for us. We do not know what you are doing. We have no clue what's happening. We do not know what we are supposed to do. Where are those signs? And then he says, we do not know how long this is going to be, right? Very quickly, the next verse. Psalm 80, verse 4. Psalm 80, verse 4. O Lord God Almighty, how long will your anger smolder against the prayers of your people? When are you going to answer the prayers of your people? How long are you going to ignore the prayers of your people? How long? Right, next. Psalm 82, verse 2. 82, verse 2. How long will you defend the unjust and show partiality to the wicked? How long will you defend the unjust? When are you going to do righteousness? How long am I going to see injustice happening to your people? How long? So I think you would have got the idea by this time, right? Look at all those psalms. There's one common thread that runs through all those psalms. There's one thought that's troubling the psalmist. That's how long? How long will God take to move on my behalf? How long it's going to take for God to do a miracle in my life? How long? You know, that's precisely what he's saying. You know, say, I have no miraculous signs. There's nothing that we could see. All your miracles of long ago have dried up. We have no prophetic signs. We do not know when the situation is going to change. We do not know how long we are going to go through this agonizing wait, this endless, painful wait. We are just waiting and waiting and waiting for God to show up and nothing has happened. How long is the enemy going to oppress me? How long am I going to come under the attack and assault of the enemy in my life, in my family, in my ministry? How long? How long is this sickness going to incapacitate me? How long am I going to suffer in the sickness that weakens my body? I'm sure you all resonate with those kind of questions, right? How long? How long, oh Lord, will it take for you to do this one miracle in my life? The book of Psalms is full of questions, full of questions. There's a very thin line between questioning God and doubting God, right? So if you read those Psalms, I'm sure the Psalms are the most familiar portion of scriptures because we resonate, we relate with it so beautifully. That's why somebody said, I find my name and my address in the book of Psalms, because every time I go with a problem, I find exactly the psalmist is addressing my problem. I find my answers, right? Because it's full of questions. David was plagued with so many questions, and you have all those questions here. One of the things that troubled David was, you know, God was taking a long time. He was very silent for a long time. God isn't speaking. You know, imagine this silence, this deafening, deadening silence in David's life. Because he never wanted this. All of a sudden, one day Samuel showed up and said, you're going to be the next king of Israel. He anointed him, and then he had to wait for 13 long years. The kind of experiences that he had in his life. You know, he says, there's a step between me and death. Saul is almost, he almost killed me. You know. And then God is so silent about the promise that he made. Right? And all these questions, Asaph is asking so many questions here. How long, O Lord? And God doesn't rebuke him for those questions. All those questions you find in the Bible, God doesn't rebuke his people. In fact, he embraces those questions because those questions come from a context of faith. That's why you have all those questions in the Bible. You find all such different kinds of questions recorded in the Bible. Questioning God is different from doubting God. Doubt is a different animal. When you doubt God, you challenge God's sovereign authority, God's promises, and God's very character. And people say, you know what? I don't believe God anymore. You know, unless he does something, I'm not going to believe this. I waited for too long. I don't think he's going to. It's waited for too long. It's gone. You know, it's over. You know, I've just come to my tethers and I can't wait anymore, you know. Unless I see something very positive, unless I see something very real, something very tangible, I'm not going to just believe this. You know, you're actually questioning the very character of God, right? Doubt is the opposite of faith, is the enemy of God. But every question, every emotion, every hurt, every frustration, you can bring it to God in the context of faith. And God answers all those questions. I want to tell you this morning, God will answer every question that you have in your heart. Every question. Sometimes we go through a difficult situation and we scramble to find answers. We don't find convincing answers to why things are happening in our life. We are only having these questions. You know, why? Why is this happening? How long it's going to go on? What is rationally God is trying to do? Actually, all those questions, you can bring it to God. All your hurts, all your disappointments, all your frustrations, all your delays, you can bring it to God in the context of faith and God will answer all those questions. Let's see how Asaph brings this to God. He also goes through those same anxieties, same frustrations as much as you and I go through in life. You can resonate very well with what he's saying here. He also faces such disappointments. He doesn't know what happened to God. God is just missing from the scene. And let's see how he brings this to God. So we're going to read a few more verses from Psalm 77. I said these are a collection of psalms that's written by Asaph. You know, I'm just trying to narrow down the crux of this message, right? So let's read Psalm 77. We're going to read from verses 5 down to 14. I want you to follow with me. Psalm 77, verses from 5 to 14. Now you have these barrage of questions there. You know, these questions that's targeted against God. Let's read this. 5, verse 5. Okay. I thought about the former days, the years of long ago. I remembered my songs in the night. My heart mused and my spirit inquired. Will the Lord reject forever? Will he never show his favor again? Has his unfailing love vanished forever? Has his promise failed for all time? Has God forgotten to be merciful? Has he forgotten? Has he in anger withheld his compassion? Then I thought, to this I will appeal, the years of the right hand of the Most High. I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago. I will meditate on all your works and consider all your mighty deeds. Your ways, O God, are holy. What God is so great as our God? You are the God who performs miracles. I'll give you a short, brief background to this whole incident that's happening here. The context of this passage is the destruction of the temple of Jerusalem, right? It's God's city. The people, the prophets, the priests, the king, they were so confident because it's God's city. God dwelt in that city. You know, you read, we have read it over and over again. We have said it over and again this morning. You know, when Moses dedicated, God's presence came down. The only race on planet earth where God expressed his desire to live among them. When Solomon dedicated the temple, the glory of God, the tangible cloud of God's presence came down. We say Shekinah, right? Shekinah is a Hebrew word. Shekinah means cloud. But the root word is Shekin. Shekin means he dwelt. That's where it comes from. Shekin is... it's a person. God came and dwelt. He dwelt. Because he dwelt, his Shekinah glory was lingering there. Right? So they were so confident, absolutely confident, that we are God's people. God is present among us. So we are invincible. Nothing can happen to us. Jerusalem is invincible because it's God's eternal city. So, but what happened has shaken and shocked the nation, has shaken the faith. The enemy has rampaged the city. It's been destroyed. Scholars believe it has happened during probably the time of, they are differing in their opinions. Probably it's during the time of a Syrian invasion or during the time of an Egyptian invasion. But what happened is that they came and attacked the temple. They stripped off the gold, the place where people met God. He couldn't come to terms with that. What he has seen with his eyes. Asaph is saying, where are you, God? Where is your presence? Where are your promises? How could the enemy have such access to come into your holy city and rampage us? The place that we met with you, they have come and stripped off all the gold that Solomon laid it in the temple. There's been a constant threat that he's coming, but they all were under this, that is huge, you know, assurance and confidence that God will protect. But what has happened? Where are you? How long are we going to undergo this assault of the enemy? So these are the anxious questions that Asaph is having. And that's why you have these barrage of questions. You know, will you reject us forever? Because you've been silent for too long. Have you forgotten us? Have you forgotten to be merciful to us? Has your unfailing love gone forever? Lord, when will you show up? And then verse 10. And then as he is lamenting, languishing in obscurity, as these thoughts are assailing him, as these questions are tormenting him, and all of a sudden you will find a transition there in verse 10. Then I thought to myself. Then I thought. You know what? Everything changes when your thinking changes. Your battles are fought in your mind. The devil tries to, you know, give all sorts of things and battle it out in your mind. When you begin to think differently, that's when your perception changes. Verse 10 says, then I thought, to this I will appeal. I will appeal to the ears of the right hand of the Most High. I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago. He said, Lord, I'm going to. Suddenly, all of a sudden, something happens. His thoughts, he turns his gaze from his problem, from the situation that's going on, from all the questions that's assailing him. From that point, he just transitions and he says, Lord, I will start thinking about the wonderful things that you have done. I will remember your miracles of long ago. Yes, you're a God who has been doing miracles. We have seen that. This nation has seen it. We have seen. We have heard it. You've opened the Red Sea. You've rained manna from heaven. You took care of your people. You opened the river Jordan. You've promised everything for us. We have seen your miracles of long ago. I will begin to think. I will meditate. You know what meditation? When you begin to ponder, you pause for a moment and you begin to ponder who God really is. You begin to meditate on the character of God. When you begin to meditate on the character of God, your whole disposition changes. It's very interesting. He says, you know, my heart mused and my, verse 6, my spirit inquired. He's musing. He's meditating. Will the Lord reject forever? All the thoughts in his mind is, you see, the word muse actually means meditate. He's constantly thinking, will God forget me? Will God leave me? Has he stopped being faithful? Has he stopped being merciful? What's going on? Where is he? Why is that happening? He's just musing, meditating on all of those things. What has happened in the past? What has happened in his life? And then all of a sudden he stops and he changes. I will meditate on the works of God. I will meditate. I will remember the miracles of long ago. He backtracks. It's very important in your life. I'll tell you, this is very, very important in your life. We need to backtrack in our lives, the journey that we have with God, to have a real good revelation of who God is. We have to backtrack sometimes. We have to go back and think, man, how good God has been. Don't look at the present situation and get stuck in the rut. You need to look back and see how faithful God has been. I know we are living in an upward mobile generation, right? I'm sure you're familiar with that word, upwardly mobile generation, upward mobile lifestyle. We are always looking at moving forward in life, you know, climbing the social ladder of success. We want to climb the social ladder of position. We want to become richer. We want to become famous. We want to make our presence felt. It's all about moving forward, you know. We want to upgrade our lives, upgrade our cars. Everything is about, I don't want to be in the place where I am today, probably 2 years later. We are always moving. It's an upward mobile life, right? Our lifestyle is changing. We are constantly getting adapted to the things that's happening. We're going to be pure with what's there happening in the society, right? It's an upward, mobile life, generation. The Bible tells us something very different, you know. Bible tells us we need to go backward to find God at times in our lives. I've been reading a book on a biography of Hudson Taylor. You know, Hudson Taylor is the first missionary to China, and he is the founder of China Inland Missions. And the title of this book is Moving Forward on Your Knees. And Hudson Taylor said, I have found there are three stages in every great work of God. Three stages in every great work of God. One is impossible. That's the first. Second is difficult. And the third one is done, right? And this middle part, you know, the difficult stage is where we all get stuck with. The difficult part. That's when your life doesn't move. That's when you have these questions. That's when you have these temptations. That's when you have these challenges. That's when you go through frustrations. And this middle phase in your life, the difficult part is where you need to stay strong, stay close with God, stay in an intimate relationship with God. That's the most difficult part. And you know, that takes a lot of waiting and hearing from God. You need to pause. That's when you need to pause. You need to stay connected with God. You need to find where God is in your life at times. It's a very interesting biography. It talks about moving forward on your knees. And this is what he says. This is when you should pause and wait on God. You cannot rush and become impatient. That is when you learn to go forward on your knees. I'm going to tell you something this morning. There are two significant places in your life. There are two significant places. Number one, the place you met God. Number two, the place you missed God. That's very significant places in all your lives. Every one of us at some point of time, there is a place that we met God. I'm not talking about your Bible reading. I'm not talking about the prayer that you do, you know, every day. I'm talking about a dramatic experience that you had with God, and you knew that you met God. It changed your life. It's an experience. It happens now and then. All of us have those experiences. You need to go back to that place. You need to go back to that place. I have so much of experiences like that. I'm sure you would have had. Probably it happened 5 years back, and probably it's happening today. I don't know. Or maybe it has happened a couple of years back. Or maybe it happened yesterday. But there is a place in your life where you know that you have met God. You have to backtrack to that place. Because that's where you find faith. It's a reservoir of faith. You know that God was there right at that moment in your life. We have our fasting and prayer, our church fasting and prayer every year, 21 days of fasting and prayer. You know, we do that every year for a season. You know, one of those 21 days of fasting and prayer, on the fifth day of fasting and prayer, it's for the church, the whole church comes together and fasts. On the fifth day of fasting and prayer, I had a dream. I'm not going to share the dream with you, but I had a dream. And in that, I met God. It was, in the sense, God addressed the present situation that I was going through very clearly. There was a struggle in my life. I'm battling with some sort of questions about my ministry. And God addressed the present situation and also gave me a glimpse of the future. I go back to that very often. That's the place that I met God. And every time I go back to that place, I find my faith back. I have a habit of, you know, reading and writing down. I write down my notes. I write down every day. I have my book. I write down every day. I have a date when I write down. My wife is my witness. She knows I like writing with pen. You know, unfortunately, I couldn't take a printout because we have just moved in. I was looking for a Xerox, you know, shop, no printout. So unfortunately, I have to use the tab. I'm very comfortable with my paper, pen, and taking my notes. So I write it down. I put out the date and I write it down. So I go back to that. Sometimes a couple of years later, I go back and I read it. Did God really speak to me this? All that I've forgotten. Everything which God speaks to us just evaporates into thin air. That's what the devil tries to do in your life. And he gets you knocked out. He gets you, you know, cluttered. He gets you absolutely bound with your present circumstances. All that remains is those unending questions that tries to bother and trouble you, because your situation never changes. Very often I go back to my notes. Sometimes I have written on 2015, 2017, right at the opening of that book. I go back and I read, and I know this is where I met God. You need to go back to that place. I do not know. God might remind you of some day in your life, some moment, some situation that you went through in life. You know God met you. You have to go back to that place. The second significant place in your life is the place where you missed God. It's a place where we all miss God. You know why? Because there's a danger of presumption in all our lives. We think that God is with us, mostly. Many times in our life, we are very busy, we are doing so many things, we have so many plans, right? And there are a lot of things, we don't want to take disappointments, we have already planned to do certain things, and then you rush into it because you've taken for granted that God is already there with you. It's one of the greatest dangers of presumption. You presume that God is with you, and then all of a sudden you realize that He's missing. All of us have that. I have an empty number of stories like that to tell you. You know there is a significant place in your life you realized that you missed God. I'll just read one verse, Luke chapter 2, verse 44. Just turn to Luke chapter 2, verse 44. It's a very interesting story about Jesus being taken by his parents to the temple to dedicate him. It was Bar Mitzvah, right? He was 12 years old. He had to go to the temple. It's right at the beginning of the story. Follows the story of the birth of Jesus. Luke chapter 2, verse 44. What does it say? Luke chapter 2, verse 44. Thinking that he was in their company, they moved on. Thinking, presuming that Jesus was there. They all came. They all came in their bandwagon. There was a festival. The feast was going on. And they all came and they worshiped God. And then thinking, they were all going back. The parents are going back. Joseph and Mary is going back. Thinking Jesus, presuming that Jesus was in their company, they moved on, and then all of a sudden they realized he wasn't there. He wasn't there. They missed Jesus. And then you know what? They have to come back to that place. You have to come back to that place. They backtrack 3 days of journey, coming back, searching for Jesus. Where is he? Where is he? And then they finally find him in the temple. That's what happens sometimes in life. We miss God. We presume that God is there. And so many of us have gone through circumstances and situations in life. The place you grieved God. The place you hurt God. That one step, that one decision that you made in your life. You know that God is grieved and you're not able to reconcile with that. That has affected your life. You have to get back to that place and deal, threadbare those follies. Take it heart to heart with God, and you have to resolve it, because that's the place that you missed God. What is Asaph telling us here? It's okay. What is Asaph telling us here is it's okay. Whatever's happened in your life, when you go back and you meditate on who God is, God changes your circumstances and your situation. Psalm 77, verse 13 and 14. I'm going to read that. That's the message for all of us. I'm going to close in the next 5 minutes. Psalm 77, verse 13 and 14. That's where the whole passage transitions. And that's where you and I want to be. That's the place that you and I want to be. Psalm 77, verse 13 and 14. What does it say? Your ways, O God, are holy. What God is so great as our God? You are the God who performs miracles. From crying out loud, there's no miracles, there's no signs, there's no prophetic guidance. How long we have to wait? How long is this agony is going to endure? How long? Where are you? What happened to your presence? How can you allow the enemy to assault us to this extent? With all those questions tormenting him, finally he cries out, with a faith of declaration. What does he say? You are the God of miracles. Your ways, you've been questioning God's ways, and all of a sudden you say, your ways, oh God, are holy. Your ways are holy. What God is so great as you? And then comes the clincher. You are the God who performs miracles. I have no doubt about it. After all the gamut of going through the gamut of feelings, the ups and downs, the struggles, you know, the questioning, and finally he comes to that place as he begin to look back and see and meditate on the wonders of God. He says, you are the God who performs miracles. You know what? Interestingly, for the first time I found, I don't know if you have found this before, for the first time I find this specific name attributed to God in the Bible. Nowhere else I found. Have you ever found this one? You are the God of miracles anywhere else in the Bible? I've never found it. There are many names of God, right? Elohim, God of creation. El Shaddai, God Almighty. El Elyon, God Most High. You know, and what is God of miracles? I found out it's El Pele. Pala is miracles. El Pele is God of the miracles. I think first time Asaf had a revelation of who God is. You know, all the names of God are compound names. El is God, and then Shaddai is Almighty. He is, you know, a mighty man of valor with the breasts of a mother. What was God telling Abraham is that I am your father and your mother. I am all powerful to protect you. And, you know, a man, a mighty man of valor with the breasts of a mother. I am there to take care of you, nurture you. That's what God is saying. Abraham had a revelation of who God is. It's compound names. El is God. Shaddai is Almighty. El is God. El Roi is a God who sees me. It's a character of God. It's not just a title. He's a God. He's what he is. Hagar was running down in the desert away from the abuse of a mistress. And he was in a place where no human, absolutely impossible for anybody to find her. She knew she was going to die. Right? The Bible says the geographical location is somewhere between Kadesh and Bered. You know, it's right at the end of, you know, the border of Egypt, because she's an Egyptian. She wants to go back to Egypt, and she's lost in the middle of a horrible desert. Nobody could find her. And then God speaks to her. God found Hagar. She says, you are the God who sees me, El Roi. That's the character of God. If you're hurting, if you're lonely, if you're lost, God will find you. El Roi, El Pele, God of the miracles. He said, I found it. That's his character. That is who God is. I cannot question him anymore, because that's his nature. He is a God of the miracles. Nothing can stop him from performing miracles in my life. I believe he is still on the throne. I believe he will come through once again. You know when that transition happens? When you begin to understand the revelation of who God is. I think Charles also said that this morning, right? You need to have a revelation of who God is. When you have that, your life changes. Your miracle is on the way. So it's okay to mess up. You've messed your life, it's okay. God can turn a mess into a miracle. It's okay, you know. I keep messing up a lot of times and I come back to God. I know I'm incapable of making the right decision, so I make a lot of mess. I recently made a big mess. We have to wait and see. I booked my tickets for Israel, right? Because we found the lowest cost airline for 36,000, and everybody was going, oh, wow, 36,000, impossible. I thought we were going to do an independent, you know, travel to Israel to scout the land for 3 weeks. And then finally, the travel agent throws a bombshell. It's impossible for Indian, Bangladesh, Pakistanis to go independent. You have to go with the travel agent. And he gives us a humongous budget. Right? I've dragged two innocent people along with me. You know what I said? I said, Lord, I've again made a mess of it. I've again made a mess. Now, I don't know what to do, but you have to rescue me from this mess. That's what children do, right? Kids, that's what they do. It's the dad who saves the day. It's the dad who comes for the rescue all the time. I said, Lord, you are my father. You are my dad. I messed it up. I do not know. I'm right now in a fix. But this is a very clear mess that I've made into. Right? But please rescue me. And you know what? He will do it. We can always come back to God. In the midst of all the mess that's happening around, Asaph was able to see God. It's a God who performs miracles, right? What we see here is not as a result of what happened in the last 2 months, right? It's not about you know, designers, architects coming and setting up the place. It's not a matter of what happened in 2 months we see this beautiful place. It's not. It's because of the last 2 years we prayed. It was an agonizing wait. Of course, we had questions. I had questions. How every time I walk into that lane, you know, in our old church, we always had this frustration. We had all that, you know, but we prayed and we prayed and we prayed and we trusted in who God is. Like, it's not a result of what happened. All of a sudden, something changed. 2 months, we had a new place and we were setting up this and everything looks, you know, beautiful and it's a perfect picture, perfect. So we have endured 2 years or probably 1.5 years of praying and waiting and believing that God could do a miracle. And God does it. Amen. So He is a God who turns our mess into a miracle. Maybe you're waiting for something. Maybe you're still questioning. Maybe you're still waiting. But I want to tell you this morning, we have El Pele, God of the miracles, who can change our lives upside down. Amen. So may God bless you this morning. I just want you to believe that your questions will be answered. God will come through because we have a God who is an expert, who is a master in miracles, and He will do that for us. Amen. Can we close our eyes and look up to the Lord? Can we close our eyes and look up to the Lord? Father, we want to thank You, Lord, this day. I don't know what are the questions that Your people have in their hearts this morning. What are the things that they have carried in their lives? I don't know what place they are right now in this journey with You. But I pray, Father, this morning they will just look back and take courage. They will look full into the perfect character of who God is. They will have a revelation of who You are, Lord. Not about our circumstances, but who God is. You are the God who performs miracles, performs wonders. You have done it. You have been consistent in doing miracles. And we believe it this morning. We believe this morning that You will do a miracle in the lives of Your people who have come here, Master. Because You are a God who stands by Your word. That's Your character. That's Your nature. That's who You are. It's not a title that's been attributed to God by mere mortal men. It's a revelation of God. El Shaddai, You are God Almighty. You have the power to change our circumstances. El Roi, You are a God who sees us in our distress, and You hear our prayers, oh God. You're El Pele, the God of miracles. There's nothing that's impossible with You. That's Your character. That's Your character. That's Your nature. And we put our faith in that this morning. We don't look at this changing circumstances of life, but we look at the unchanging nature of God. They're unchanging yesterday, today, and forever. And You're the same. And what You did 2,000 years back, You're able to do it today, now in the lives of Your people. You're the God of miracles. We confess that this morning. And I pray that You will change every life this morning. I pray whatever the questions that they have, whatever the needs that they carry this morning, oh Lord, I pray that You will meet them today. Once again. Once again. Let them know that You are the God of miracles. And I bless Your people. I bless every one of them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Let's bow for the benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now until Jesus comes again. Amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. God bless you. There's a couple of minutes. You know, I want to really thank God for this blessings, this beautiful place. You know, unless the Lord builds the house, the laborers build in vain. Everything is about God, right? It says, the Latin phrase is nisi dominus frusta. You know, the Scottish has that in their coat of arms because they said, even if you have to build a nation, unless the Lord builds it, it's all a frustration. So we can say that over and over and over again. all through the day, shouted from the rooftops, you know, without God, nothing is possible in our lives. We want to thank God. Can we give the Lord a hand of praise once again for what He's done? Right? So, and also thank you, church. I know there's so much of work that's gone in. And I really want to thank, I don't have, you know, I can't take those names, but I want to thank all the men and women, you know, right from the time, you know, we have to shift the from the old church, you know, carrying things and sometimes climbing up the 5 floors when the lift was not working. So, and all the women who were there, who helped us, who cleaned up the place, you know, and I have no words. Words are not adequate to express how much you mean. I'm so thankful to God for the wonderful church, wonderful people that I have, so blessed. But thank you. Can we give the Lord a hand for the entire church, all of them who came and helped? You know, I want to tell you that I'm very blessed because I have such a faithful bunch of people. They are so faithful to God. And I'm really blessed. You know, there's so many of them. I can really trust them. You know, that's the kind of people that we have. And there are so many of them. I can't name them, but today I have to really thank there's one person who single-handedly shouldered the whole responsibility of setting this space, this facility. You know, he faced the brunt of this whole project, right? And Praveen has been so faithful. Praveen, you know, I can't tell you how we can go on without, you know, Praveen, even if it's harvesters or it is Shiloh, you know, he's the man for the moment. So thank you so much, Praveen. I'm sure the Lord will reward you for your faithfulness. You know, but we want to just give you a small token, you know, just to thank you for the work that you have put in day and night. You know, he was full-time job working as a HR and then coming and overseeing and all of that. You know, of course, you know, I want to thank Peter. Peter, let's give Peter a hand. Let me not forget Peter. Peter was fully here, overseeing all the work, you know. So thank you so much, Peter. Thank you. Okay, so God bless you. I'm sure the Lord will bless all of you who have selflessly, you know, given yourself, you know, for the Lord. So God bless you. So Praveen, can I just call you? I would ask Pastor Deepak to just give away this memento. Can we give the Lord a hand? Thank you, Praveen. God bless you. So thank you, everyone. All those who have come here accepting our invitation. We are so blessed to have you. I'm sure you've been blessed as well, you know, worshiping together with us this morning. So God bless you. And we have 10 minutes, sir. Okay. The food is arrived here. Okay. It'll take 10 minutes for them to organize. So please stay back and enjoy the fellowship lunch with us. Thank you very much. God bless.